Why's it gotta It doesn't make 2 weeks. Only 3 hours. Then we wrap it in this brandy cloth and store it in the cellar until Christmas. Bring me the molasses, please. Thank you. And hand me that cup of cherries. As usual, we're a little long on nuts and a little short on fruit this year, but I suppose it'll turn out all right. Would you like to help stir?
My hand.
Oh, I'm sorry. You were telling me before about nativity practice. Are you a shepherd again?
No, this time I'm one of the kings. The king that brings the mirror.
What mirror?
That's what Pastor Belt said. Joy brings the gold, wolf brings the frankincense, and I bring the mirror.
Oh, that mirror. Who else is in the play?
Billy's Joseph, Harriet Spillman's the head angel, and Edith Wetzel is the Virgin Mary. She and Harriet got into a big argument over who got the biggest part. Edith said she had a bigger part because it was harder to be a virgin than an angel.
On the mouth of things.
And Billy brought his father's cow ladder.
His what?
It's this round thing that you blow up with air, and you sit on it, and it sounds just like...
I know the sound.
Well... He blew it up and hid it on the haystack next to the manger, and Harriet floated in all angel-like and said, "As it came to pass." Soon after that, Pastor Phil told us all to go home.
I'm not surprised. What surprises me is you boys not behaving yourselves.
But I didn't do it. Billy did.
But you knew he put that cow bladder there. You could have warned Harriet.
But Mama...
I'm not scolding. I'm just saying, this close to Christmas, I would think you'd be on your best behavior. Chris Kindle could be watching. And you know he doesn't bring presents to troublemakers.
Billy says we don't have to worry about that.
Oh, really?
He says that Chris Kindle takes his time watching City Boys because they live close together. He doesn't want to watch us because we're all spread out.
I wouldn't be too sure about that. It seems to me that if Chris Kindle can manage to bring you a present, he can manage to look in on you now and again.
Remarkableness overwhelms me.
When you're finished with the nuts, you can peel all the apples and the carrots and the turnips. I forgot the potatoes. You can wash down the walls, mend the shirts, darn the mittens. You can dry all the dishes. You can grind up the pepper. You can dust off the books. You can polish all the silver. You can open up the cans. You can wash off the table. You can slice off the bread.
Slice off the bread.
When you're done, there's more.
More? Do you think Papa will bring me a Christmas present from Chicago?
Could be.
When are he and Opa getting back?
Let's see, what's today? The 11th? He thought they'd be home by the 15th. But of course it all depends.
On what?
On the weather, the winds. Excuse me.
What do you think he'll bring me?
I don't know.
If he did bring me something, could I open it right away?
Of course not. You've got to wait till Christmas.
But December is the longest month of the year.
It is this year. Meanwhile, there's plenty to do. I've got baking. You've got chores. Did you give Diamond Lady her feedback?
Yeah, she was hungry too.
And chop all the firewood like I asked?
Some.
We'll go finish. It's getting dark. Thank the good Lord, there's always plenty to do.
Thanks.
Just measure the raisins, just measure the walnuts and raisins, mix in the flour and butter and cinnamon, nutmeg too. Oh, Carl, you forgot!
Come on, Mr. Stossel.
Peter, what?
I'm back early. Disappointed?
Oh, dear Lord, no!
You know, he's got one like you in every port.
Welcome home, Chris.
Where's Carl?
I just sent him out to finish chopping the firewood, but how did
you... I wanted to hear this too. Carl! Carl!
Pa, that you?
Come on in, son.
That walk up to the never gets any little shorter.
Is it here, Mama?
You bet! Opa!
Hey, Carl, missed you. You wouldn't believe what happened. We pulled into the Clark Street dock and there was what? 500, maybe 600 people there waiting for us.
Waiting?
Yeah, and they even had a sign. Welcome, Christmas Schooner. Can you believe it?
Martha had gone around her entire neighborhood telling everyone a schooner was coming in to build Christmas trees. They've been waiting dock sites this morning. I thought it might take us a week to sell all the trees.
If we could sell them at all.
By evening of that first night, there wasn't a tree left. We had sold every one.
That's great. Did you bring me anything?
So I gave the crew the next day off to see the sites and do some shopping, and then we hoisted anchor and came home.
Oh, Peter, that's wonderful.
I've been sweeping.
You should have seen their faces on the older couples and children alike.
Chopping firewood?
And this little girl came up to me to show me the paper ornament she had for the tree. She's never even seen a Christmas tree, but her parents had told her.
Feeding the stock?
Everyone's talking about where they're going to put the tree and how they're going to decorate it. It was a big party right there on the dock. And they were singing, Joy to the World.
And we were singing, Make way for the Molly. Make way.
Tomorrow on the sled.
It was on our way. We knew she'd be anxious.
What?
The grandfather clock you've been watching.
Seth Thomas!
Oh, Peter!
Where do you want it?
The front room for now, I guess.
We can bind it up later.
You heard her. Front room.
Thanks, us.
That covers Ma's present. So now...
Now I gotta warm up.
I've got the fire going in the parlor. Tell the boys I'll bring in them some coffee, and I've got a little strudel left.
So tell me, Carl, what have you been up to?
Oh, I've been doing a lot. I've been shoveling, baking bread.
It must have cost a fortune.
Never mind. You deserve it.
I think I need to stoke the fire.
You're doing fine.
I need the strudel. The strudel might be a little dry. I baked it Sunday.
Put down the strudel.
I need the tray. I can't. I need you to.
You know, Peter, we were talking. If we move some of that decking starboard of the mast, we could probably put trees all over the deck and double our load.
Huh? Of course, it means starting earlier, cutting next year.
Yeah.
Oh.
What next year?
Oh.
Why, the second voyage of the Christmas schooner, of course. Peter told him we'd be back with more trees, and I figured if we lashed them on the deck, we could get a much larger load. Of course, we'd have to watch our weight. Did I say something?
You said this once.
Oh, I know.
Peter, you sailed on a winter lake, and you made it this year. What about next year? The year after? Peter, you have so much. A home, a family, a thriving business. Why risk it?
Because we have so much. More of them keep coming every day. Hundreds without decent jobs or places to live. It's getting harder and harder for them all. I didn't know what compelled me. I think the trees initially, an old feeling, a memory, maybe. I didn't even know if it was the right thing to do until I saw their faces. Their smiles as they picked a tree and carried it off, but then there were the faces of those who didn't get a tree. I'm sorry, I told them. That's all we brought. One man actually cried. He stood on the dock with tears in his eyes, hoping I could somehow magically produce a tree. It meant that much to him. What could I tell them? I can only say that we'd be back next year with more trees. I'm sorry, Oliver, but if you could have just seen their faces...
I don't care about their faces. I care about your face. I care about you.
I hear someone ask if I brought my Christmas present.
I gave up hope.
Well, never fear, my lad. I think you'll find something to your liking on the table. Do you want to open it in the parlor?
You mean I can open it now?
Sure. Now. Come on, Steve.
It's heavy.
Go on. Open it.
Oliver.
Is it something I asked for?
I think so.
When it's ready.
Skates! Pa! New skates!
Single blades, too. They'll fit around in your shoes.
They're great!
Look at those.
Ma! Come look at my new skates!
I wanted to give them to you after Christmas, but...
Stop some!
Christmas came a little early this year.
Ma! Ma!
Maybe just a little.
Are you fine here?
I'm fine.
I've got to get back to Peru.
I'm coming with you.
Sit.
You're not going anywhere.
Here you go, Opa.
It's too much.
It's perfect.
How much load have you got left?
This will be our final load. We have to lash some of the trees onto the deck and we can set up tomorrow morning.
I'll be ready.
No, you're not going anywhere. I have no time to captain the schooner and nurse you.
But you're already a man now.
I'll get Roy Summers.
He went to Green Bay yesterday.
What about John Barclay?
His wife hasn't delivered that baby yet. He won't leave her.
How about me?
No.
I've been shipping up for 3 years now. I know the Molly Doom as good as anyone.
Those were summer runs, Carl. Sailing in winter is a whole other thing altogether.
And I need you here.
Opa will be able to help around here in a few days, won't you?
Yeah.
You're still a boy.
I'm 15. I know the schooner, and I know what's expected of me.
You have school.
I can make it up. Pop.
Peter.
I need a man who knows the lake and knows this boat. When I figure that's cool.
Yes!
Peter!
He'll be fine. He's been watching his Opa sail. What happens when you spit on the windward side of the boat?
The spit comes right back in your face.
That's all you need to know.
Let's get you into bed.
I want my whiskey.
Tell him, Dermot.
Tell him, but he won't listen.
Feet on the jib and 900 Jim.
And who christened her the Molly Doom?
Her first owner, Captain T.L. Goodman, 1858.
Do you know how a sailor can tell rain by his nose?
No? How?
If his nose is wet,
it's raining! Stories. But being in a storm like that, water is smashing everything. Steve ran to the stern cabin to grab some flares, but when they finally got the water, the lifeboat in the water, most of them were soaked. They finally got one to fire up. When Rusty built bodies, and our bicycles, and from our coats, our hair. Captain Thompson, he's the skipper of the Lady Hayes, the boat that found us. He said we weren't but a quarter mile from the shore. Powell's got us to safety. Almost.
Gus, we heard you were here. I'm sorry. We're all sorry.
He came as soon as we got the wire. We trained down to a marionette and took the ferry across the bay.
Mrs. Stossel, I speak for the crew in saying that Captain Stossel is the finest man we've ever shipped out under.
Steve, we're just glad that you and the others are all right.
Jill took quite a beating. If it hadn't been for your husband, ma'am, we wouldn't be here at all. Now, he kept his bearings in the middle of that snowstorm. He couldn't see a blasted thing for hours. But somehow he knew the bay was on our starboard. He held the schooner into the wind until the rest of us got on the lifeboat. I'm just sorry that he... Like I said, we'll never sail under a better captain.
Thanks, Steve.
Do you remember when George Hoffman was drowned?
Sure. Just 3 summers back. He went overboard off Wiggins Reef. We searched, but he never came up.
I brought a casserole to his wife the next week. Left with those 3 girls. The whole time I was there, she never said a word. Just looked. But all the time I knew she was thinking, why is your husband alive and mine drowned? I've never been able to look her in the eye since. Maybe now I can.
We'll leave you folks alone.
Wait, Steve, I think we should tell her.
Why don't you wait a bit?
We don't have time to wait. We have to get there.
Where? Tell me what?
Captain Thompson, the skipper I was telling you about.
What about him?
He came to see us in the hospital last night. You see, the trees, in the storm, they broke their lashings. And
Mrs. Stossel, when the Molly broke and went under, everything in the cargo boat was set loose. 2 or 3 days after the wreck, all of the trees began washing up on shore. Hundreds of them from one end of the bay to the other. Captain Thompson came to Carl, him being the son, to see what he wanted done with them.
Done? Get rid of them! I never want to see another Christmas tree again!
But Ma, he's got a schooner. It's laid in for winter right now, but it wouldn't take but a day or two to get her ready.
Ready for what?
He's got a full crew, Ma. They'll help us load the rest of the trees onto the boat. And, see, today's Tuesday. Steve says we should weigh anchor by Saturday.
Weigh anchor? You're telling me after what you just went through, you'd actually go out on that lake again?
Mrs. Stossel, we took a vote. And we decided to a man it was what Captain Stossel would want us to do.
You and the boys can do what you like. It's your lives. But Carl's not going anywhere but home. By train every inch of the way if I could.
Ma, we voted. And we decided. I'm going to Chicago with those trees.
You listen good. You decide nothing! I lost my husband because of those trees. I'm not going to lose you too.
Once we're under sail, we can be in Chicago in a couple of days.
No.
Opa, we haven't said a word. What do you think?
I think you two ought to go back to your rooms and let your Ma and I discuss this.
But Opa!
Go.
But I...
Just go.
Don't ask me to say yes. I can't.
I'm not gonna tell you what to do.
All week long, I've watched you. Waited for you to cry out. He was your son. How can you do nothing but carry on each morning like any other day? Stirring your coffee and rocking and rocking and sitting every evening, filling up your pipe, drinking your whiskey and reading your journal.
questions?
No. Peter knew that that same wind that was his friend, that filled his sails and made his living, could turn and be an angry force against him. And he knew the calm waters that lapped on his bow could rise up 50 feet and fall down on him and, yes, be his grave. But those were the laws he lived with, that he accepted. And that man who was your husband and my son could come into our lives and make every day we lived with him a treasure, could be taken from us. Those are the laws that we must live with, that we must accept. Would you rather he had never lived, never come into our lives?
No.
Then if we accept our blessings, we must accept our pain. Do I weep that my son died? I weep. Did I weep when my wife, my Granta, died? I wept. But if we weep, it's because we have loved and been loved.
Yes.
I loved my son. And that's why I think Carl and the other men should take those trees to Chicago. And I know one old gray-haired son of a sea cook who's going with them.
I'll never understand.
I was there once when you asked Peter, why are you going? Remember what he said? He said, because if I don't do it, it won't get done. Maybe that's what we're feeling now. I remember back in Bremen, I can see Peter's face the way he looked at me. People thought that I was crazy, risking everything to cross the sea. And I remember when I asked him, should we go and take a chance or should we stay?
Do it, yes, for me.
No, well, yes, we brought the trees, but you see, I knew it. I've come down here every night to speak waiting for you. I thought that I was daft, wasting my time, said the schooner sunk up north, said there weren't going to be no ship this year. But I knew he was wrong. I knew you'd come.
What's your name?
Mary Claire Doherty.
I'm Alma Stossel.
It's a pleasure, ma'am.
You're Irish. What's an Irish girl doing wanting the Tannenbaum?
And why not?
Well, I thought it was only a German tradition.
You should have seen the tree we got last year. It was almost as big as Mr. Sabatini's.
Sabatini?
They live on the floor of this. They got the biggest tree on the whole ship last year. That's why this year I'm going to be first in line to get first choice.
If your da told you that the schooner went under, what made you think the trees would be here?
They had to. I mean, what's Christmas without a Christmas tree?
You tell your da he is wrong. The Molly Dune went down, it's true. But there are other men, other ships, and lots more trees up north. You tell him the Christmas schooner sailed into Clark Street Dock this year, and it will every year.
Yes, ma'am.
Wait. You take this. Our blessings aren't ours to keep, Mary Claire. They're meant to be passed along.
May this branch bring you love. May this branch bring you love. Take it and pass it on. May this branch bring you love. Take it.
The dock for the night. Metal unloader at dawn.
And Carl?
Down in the hole checking the trees one more time before he turns in. Just like his pop.
It's a nice night. It's not too cold.
I hope the people come for the trees tomorrow. Only 5 days till the 25th.
They'll come. What's Christmas without Christmas tree?
I saw you two talking.
She knew the schooner would come.
The faith of children.
Yes.
Well, we better turn in. Busy day tomorrow.
You go ahead. I'll be along in a minute.
All right. Alma? I'm glad you came.
I had to. If I'd have let you navigate, you'd have all ended up in Nova Scotia.
Right.
Gus?
Gute Nacht. Gute
Nacht, Alma. Alma was right. A Christmas schooner sailed the next year and the year after that. She saw to it. In fact, for the next quarter century, a Christmas schooner sailed in the Clark Street Harbor each and every winter.
The names of the schooners changed.
There was the Sea Star, the Mary Collins, and the Rouse Simmons.
They were captained by other men. Albert Sibelski, Herman and August Schunemann, names long forgotten by most.
But what shouldn't be forgotten is the courage of each of these men to risk their lives and sail the lake so that others can know the joy of Christmas.
And may that same courage and that same joy be in each of us.